Miss the Saturday dance. Heard they crowded the floor. Couldn't bear it without you. Don't get around much anymore.
Well, hello and welcome to Curators in Quarantine, an informal gathering of museum curators, archaeologists, art historians, and other interested people who are impacted by the worldwide pandemic. You are listening, of course, to the great Ella Fitzgerald singing Duke Ellington's Don't Get Around Much Anymore, which seems like an appropriate theme song since we don't get around much anymore. My name is Jeffrey Spier, and I'm the senior curator of antiquities at the Getty Museum in Los Angeles, which is presently closed and will probably not reopen until early next year. I'm joined by two colleagues from Leiden University, Jorrit Kelder, an archaeologist and ancient historian based at Leiden and sometimes at Oxford University, and Willemijn Waal, university lecturer in Assyriology and Hittite at Leiden University and director of the Netherlands Institute for the Near East. So how are we doing, Jorrit? How are things in Leiden? What are you doing?
Not too bad. Well, as you say, we're not getting around much at this point in time. But then again, it does offer to an opportunity to sort of clean up my calendar and work on some articles that needed finishing. But I'm sure that goes for most of us. And of course, it's an excellent time to read up on stuff, including some of the papers that we'll probably be discussing today.
Yes. Are you teaching at all?
I'm not at the moment. I taught at Ghent University in Belgium last year, but at the moment, not so much. So that's quiet at the moment.
Willemijn, how are you? And are you teaching? Are they in person classes in Leiden?
No, unfortunately, not in person. It's all online. I'm teaching a course about the Mycenaean world, and it's nice. But well, the online situation, it's not perfect. But I think, all things considering, we're doing okay. And it does give a good opportunity to also invite guest lecturers from abroad. I mean, that's a huge advantage of online teaching. So it's not all bad.
Well, good, very optimistic. Let's keep optimistic. Anyway, Willemijn is a specialist not only in Anatolian and Semitic languages, but as she said, she's teaching Mycenaean. She has a background in Greek and Latin philology, and she's long had an interest in the relations between the cultures of the Near East and the Aegean, and recently has written several papers about the long controversial issue of the beginnings of the Greek alphabet, which I found extremely interesting. One of these, and I don't know that we can post this somewhere, is her on the Phoenician letters, the case for an early transmission of the Greek alphabet from an archaeological, epigraphic, and linguistic perspective in the online journal Aegean Studies, volume 1, 2018. And there's an interesting forthcoming paper in Journal of Hellenic Studies, which you can tell us about in a minute. But I thought we'd start with that your first big paper, where I think everyone agrees that the Greek alphabet derives from the Semitic alphabets, which are much earlier, although their origins are a bit controversial in date. It's not clear when and how this happened, so I think that's what you're addressing. The earliest surviving Greek texts date from the late 8th century BC, but they show a level of development that suggests much earlier versions existed. So it's puzzling where these are. And most ancient traditions and modern scholars believe the Greeks learned the alphabet from the Phoenicians, but there are problems with this theory as well. So I want to ask, why is it unlikely that the Greek alphabet was introduced as late as the 8th century BC?
Yeah, well, as you say, it's indeed a long-standing debate, and overall now the date of the 8th century BC or a bit earlier, the late 9th century BC is generally accepted, especially in the field of classical studies. But there have always been voices, especially in the field of Semitic studies, that argue for a much earlier date, around 1100 or so. And a very important advocate for an earlier transmission was Joseph Nave, who wrote some very important articles in the 1970s and 80s, and for which he argued for a much earlier date. And recent insights and discoveries have actually confirmed his point of view. And well, one of the main arguments why Joseph Nave said, well, the alphabet must have been introduced to Greece much earlier is the fact that if you look at these early Greek inscriptions, they resemble much more the early West Semitic writing that dates before the 11th century BC than the later Phoenician script from the 9th or 8th century BC. And well, it may be good to give some background. The alphabet we now know was already in use in Egypt and the Levant from the beginning of the second millennium BC. The oldest attestation that we have dates from around 1900 or 1800 BC. So it was already in use for quite some time. And if you look at these earliest inscriptions, well, I call them West Semitic for convenience sake, they can be seen as the forerunners of the later consonantal alphabets such as Phoenician and Hebrew and Aramaic. And well, we call them consonantal alphabets because they only record consonants and they do not have vowel signs. Well, but if you look at these early inscriptions, you see that they are quite disorganized. They are written in all kinds of directions and the letter formats are very unstable. And you see a sort of process of standardization going on in the 11th century. And then the letter forms become more stable and also the writing direction gets fixed. So for example, Phoenician starts to be written from right to left in continuous script. And if we then turn to the early Greek inscriptions, we actually see that they also have quite a messy appearance. They're written in all directions, left to right to left, horizontally, vertically, in boustrophedon. So they look very much like these early West Semitic inscriptions.
Oh, should we and have a certain... look? Let's look at an illustration from your...
Yeah.
I'll put that up on the screen here. There we go.
Yeah, and here you see these early letter forms. Actually, there's also quite some debate about the letter shapes. For example, Joseph Nave, he sees a great resemblance between these early, what he calls proto-Canaanite of early West Semitic inscriptions, whereas other scholars, such as, for example, Rice Carpenter, a very influential classical scholar, he says he's much more resembles with the later Greek, with the later Phoenician script. So there's quite some debate, and it's quite a subjective affair in a way. It's if you look at these signs, you can, what do you think is most important, their direction or the number of strokes they have. So there's quite some debate about the individual signs. But if you look at more the scribal habits in general, it's interesting that you, for example, have this direction of writing Phoenician is written from right to left. Well, Greece is first written all over the place, and later it starts to be written from left to right, so in the complete opposite direction. And another funny fact that is shared by the early Greek inscriptions and these early West Semitic inscriptions is the fact that they make use of word dividers, little vertical strokes or dots to make divisions between words. And we do not find this in the Phoenician alphabet that is written continuously, but we do see it in the West Semitic sources from before 1100 or so, and in the first Greek inscriptions. And then, yeah, you sort of wonder, you have two scenarios. So either the Greeks took over the alphabet in the 8th century from the Phoenicians, but they then ignored certain scribal habits, such as the writing direction, and mimicked older writing habits, or you could argue, well, maybe they just took the script already at an earlier date and simply took over the then existing scribal habits, such as the loose word order and the use of word divisions.
So you're saying that the Phoenicians was quite regular by the 8th century. It was always carefully written, and the Greek doesn't look like that.
Exactly.
It's a good point. I mean, you wonder how that would happen.
Yeah, and some people some people argue, well, that it's usual for new writing systems to sort of experiment with things like with word dividers and direction of writing, etc. And that may be true for newly invented writing systems, but you see usually when a writing system is taken over, usually the main scribal habits, such as direction of writing, are also taken along with it. If you look at cuneiform, for example, it has been introduced in many different cultures, and then you see that like the basics such as word order are also introduced together with the writing system.
And then there are other problems, the types of letters. You know, we have a quite big distribution of the alphabet at this early, in the 8th century.
I know, yes.
I'll show that in your, also in your article, you mentioned that.
Yeah, that's another very intriguing fact. So all of a sudden in the 8th century, we have, well, it has been called the alphabetic Big Bang, that we have suddenly have inscriptions all over the place. So in Greece, the mainland, but also the islands, also in Italy and Anatolia. And it's quite remarkable. And what's even more remarkable is that there already from the very start, there are no less than 33 different alphabets in place. And these 33 alphabets are sometimes divided into three or four main groups that you see here. So you have the red alphabets in the mainland, the green or primitive alphabets in around Crete, and the blue and the dark blue and the light blue alphabets more to the east. And this is quite interesting that you have these all these variants in place right from the very start. And we also see that related alphabets such as Etruscan starts to be written around the same time in Italy and also Phrygian in Anatolia.
Mm-hmm.
And what we see is that though these, well, so the alphabets are clearly different, and, but they also have some shared innovations. And the most important innovation is that they all have vowel signs, which are not present in these early continental alphabets. Well, and if you assume a late date, so in the 8th century, that must mean that, well, the alphabet spread at an incredible speed in a very short time over a large territory, as you say, and also that it developed very quickly because we have these different traditions in place right from the very start.
Yeah,
so it would indeed be an alphabetic Big Bang.
Yeah, yes? No, that is the problem where we have all of these at the same time, but a lot of very significant variations.
Yeah, so it might make more sense to assume that actually what we see, these different traditions that already are present in the very first attestations, that they reflect a much longer development.
Yeah.
I think one of the arguments I think that might support such a notion that they already wrote, that the Greeks already wrote much earlier than the earliest text that we have is perhaps, and I think you show at least one of those examples in your paper, is that one of the first inscriptions that we have is already a reference to basically literature and that sort of sarcastic one.
Yeah,
I have a couple, because I'm sure everyone would like to see that. These are some of the, I think this probably is our earliest Greek inscription on the so-called Dipolon jar, which is from the Dipolon Cemetery in Athens. And it seems to be a, you know, it's just scratched around the rim of the shoulder of that jug. And it seems to be a prize because it mentions dancers, whoever these dancers is, plays most delicately of him. This is probably a gift, but it's metrical already. So it's
I know,
And this must be 730 BC, something like that, I would guess.
Yeah, and I think the other example.
This is a great discovery. Yeah, found on the island of Ischia off the coast of Italy, which was a Euboean colony, a Greek colony in Italy, on a Rhodian cup, geometric cup of around 720 BC, but scratched on the side, this wonderful inscription. Did you want to describe that?
Well, as you can see here in the slide, it's called Nestor's cup for good reason, because the text is in a sort of a mocking way, a reference to King Nestor, the Homeric Eros, the king of Pylos, who supposedly held this massive golden vessel up with a weight that only he could carry. And obviously this vessel, which is inscribed, is a far stretch from this massive mythical golden vessel.
It's quite explicit. It starts with, "I am the cup of Nestor, good for drinking." Yeah. And then it goes into beautiful dactylic hexameter. You know, whoever drinks from this cup, desire for beautifully crowned Aphrodite will seize him instantly. So a reference to the Iliad and already in verse and fairly nicely written with dividers, as you say, Willemijn, between words.
Yeah. Yeah, and well, this has prompted some scholars, such as Barry Powell, to claim that, well, the Greeks started to use the alphabet to record Homer, which is, of course, a very romantic idea, but maybe not the most plausible one, because, as you say, it's quite interesting that these early texts already show perfect hexameters and are clearly inspired by Homer. But the other early text genre that we find, so on the one hand, we have these poetry lines. On the other hand, we have quite explicit erotic graffiti in recorded on caves, especially at Santorini. And both these genres, the poetry lines and obscene graffiti, are not usually the typical for primary use of writing. I mean, usually writing first starts to be used to record administrative affairs or correspondence, etc. And it's highly unlikely that the first time writing is ever used is for poetry and at the same time for pornographic graffiti. I mean, it would be quite exceptional. Don't laugh, Jorrit. It's
No, I was laughing. Pornographic graffiti, why not? It's,
So I would think it's more likely that what we are witnessing here, I mean, because it's quite interesting that we all of a sudden have these texts, that it is more... a later phase of writing, when writing was already penetrated more deeply into society and it really started to be used for private purposes and also for more playful ends, such as poetry lines and graffiti. And these kinds of texts, they were not, because, of course, the big question is, so why don't we have any earlier material?
Yeah.
And then, the most logical conclusion is that it was that the first texts were written down on perishable materials such as papyrus and leather, which are actually quite common writing materials for alphabetic writing systems. Yeah. And that only later, when writing also starts to be used for more entertaining ends, it also ends up being written on more durable materials such as pottery and rock. And therefore, those texts have come down to us.
And so this is what your new article that's coming out, it'll be in Journal of Hellenic Studies, yes?
Right, yeah.
And so this is now, it's addressing this to some degree. What is that going to be about? The origins of the alphabetic, what it was really used for in the earliest missing material, yeah?
Yeah, well, I'm also trying to, in a way it's very much related to this whole debate about the date of the alphabet. There is this expression, phonikeia grammata, which is usually translated as Phoenician letters.
Yeah.
And it is said, the explanation of Herodotus is that it refers to the Greek alphabet and that the alphabet was derived from the Phoenicians and therefore they call it Phoenician letters. But the word phoenix in Greek is actually, it's a very difficult enigmatic word, but that can have a lot of different meanings. So it can mean Phoenician, so somebody or something from Phoenicia, but it can also mean the color red, or it can refer to palm leaves or a palm tree. And this expression phoenicia grammata means letters, so Phoenician letters. The explanation of Herodotus is not the only explanation that circulated in antiquity. There are also sources that say that the phoenicia grammata actually refer to an ancient practice of writing on palm leaves. So it's palm leaf writing.
Mm-hmm.
And this is quite intriguing. Actually, if you start to look at the available evidence, there are quite some indications that actually this explanation is much more plausible than the explanation given by Herodotus.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons, I'm sorry?
Such as,
for example, if you look at the attestations of this expression phoenicia grammata, you see that it's only attested in scenes in texts that are situated during the Trojan War or in the Heroic Age, which is the period that we identify with the Late Bronze Age. And in the Late Bronze Age, we know that the Mycenaeans made use of Linear B. And that is a writing system that has, it has come down to us on clay tablets, but already a long time ago, I think it was already Arthur Evans who suggested that although we have the Linear B recorded on clay tablets, that it was not the primary writing material for the script and that it was primarily used on palm leaves. And the reason why people thought so is because of some of the characteristics of the Linear B script, which make it very, unsuitable for writing on clay, and also the shape, the format of these documents that very much resemble palm leaves. And of course, palm leaf writing is quite known from many other periods, especially from Southeast Asia. So, and well, there are some other indications, but if you take it all together, there's actually the most straightforward explanation seems to be that the phonikaya grammata, this expression, originally referred to palm leaf writing, referring to linear B that was written down on palm leaves.
Right.
But this, yeah.
This expression would have survived the Bronze Age and still.
Yeah, yes, it did.
Herodotus didn't know it, so.
No, exactly. At a certain point, you see that that the knowledge about these palm leaves writing in linear B was not current anymore. And then you see that in the 5th century, people like Herodotus, well, they're no longer aware of the original meaning of the expression, and they start to reinterpret this expression. And Herodotus was very fond of the Phoenicians. He really liked to see Phoenician intermediaries. So he said, well, it must refer to Phoenician letters to the Greek alphabet. And actually this, you could say this, well, misinformed reinterpretation of Herodotus is one of the mainstays actually that we today think that it were the Phoenicians who introduced the alphabet to Greece. Mm-hmm. Whereas it may well have been a much earlier Semitic source.
No.
So what you're arguing in a way is also that this would also really explain why we don't have any earlier evidence for the alphabet, physical evidence in Greece, because there was a tradition of writing perhaps earlier in linear B and later on, and we'll come to the exact date later on, I think, later on in alphabetic script on perishable materials such as palm leaves or the center nerve, really, of a palm leaf, I guess, yeah. Mostly.
Yeah, exactly. You're right. Yeah. And there are ancient classical sources, such as Pliny, for example. Pliny the Elder, he refers to the ancient practice on writing on leaves. And we also know from other Greek historians that, we know the practice of ostracism, that names are written down on ostraca, on potsherds. But in some regions, such as in Sicily, they wrote it down on leaves. So, indeed,
right.
Yeah. And overall, you can say that in general, if you look at the kind of materials that are used for writing alphabetic script, it's usually perishable materials. That's quite unfortunate for us. It's, in a way, you could say that cuneiform is the great exception, that it was written on clay, and clay is, well, quite durable, especially when it's burned.
Yes.
So that's really, well, distorts our view in a way.
Yeah. This is really interesting. So if we were to argue for an earlier use of the alphabet, I think in your paper you suggest an 11th or even perhaps late 12th century BC. So as you already noted earlier in our conversation, you know, normally an alphabet or any sort of script is usually used for things like administration. Think of trade or the revenues of taxes and things like that. So How would you envisage the arrival of the alphabet in the Aegean, in the Greek world, in the 11th or even 12th century BC? This is a period that's normally, I think, or at least until recently, was seen as a sort of a dark age with very little reason to write.
Yeah, but I think, as you say, that until recently, that I think nowadays we agree that the Dark Age was not all dark and gloomy, and that there was actually quite some continuity and also prosperity in the Aegean. And not unimportant that the overseas connections with, for example, the Levant continue to exist. And we know that in the Levant, from the second millennium onwards, the alphabet was in use. So. And well, since we know that there were these connections all the time, actually it seems highly unlikely that the Aegean as the only region would have been illiterate for 400 years, which is quite a long period. Especially if you think that before that time, that we just mentioned, they made use of linear B, and for at least 200 years from 1415 till 1200 or so. And before that time, even other writing systems. So altogether, they had a writing tradition already of over half a millennium. And now in the current scenario, we then have 400 years of silence and then, well, the alphabetic Big Bang, which especially if you look at the surrounding regions, especially since we now know that the Aegean was in continuous contact with other people, it seems highly unlikely, I would say. And I think this is also shows that the current paradigm is very much based on a Eurocentric outlook on history, and that Greece was for a long time seen as isolated and unique, and it was studied in isolation and not seen as, well, a part of the Mediterranean world, which of course it is.
Yeah. No, I think it's very fascinating. I think we are now starting to understand this transition from Bronze Age to Iron Age. Although we had a collapse of the palace system where we had the writing, it can't all end. And you know, we're learning that every day, how there is continuity. And I like the idea of the alphabet emerging from that. You know, I know we could talk all day, but I think we better wrap this up. We've kept you a long time, and we can do it again another day. But
I would love to.
But
can I then just finish with one query that many, especially of the classicists, would probably want to know? So if we assume an earlier literary world, an early literary Greek world, which is, you know, if the alphabet indeed did arrive in Greece in the 11th or even 12th century BC, then the gap between the late Bronze Age palatial world and basically the later literate Greek world is basically bridged, essentially.
Yeah.
So if we assume you're right and that the script arrived much earlier in Greece, how would that tally with our understanding of Homer and his stories? Does this shed some new light on our perception on Homer as well, and on the historicity, for example, of some of his tales?
Yeah, I would say yes. Actually, I think that's one of the most exciting consequences if you allow an earlier date of the alphabetic introduction, because now we're sort of stuck with this idea that Homer must have been composed and transmitted orally over centuries, because we all agree that there are some late Bronze Age relics in the epic. And if you look at Homer, it doesn't resemble a purely oral tradition at all. And especially this idea that that some elements, such as for the catalogue of ships, would have been transmitted orally for over centuries, that's really quite unlikely. I mean, there's very little evidence, if you look at anthropological studies, for such a long verbatim transmission of text. So, and also if you look at the whole compositions of Homer, I mean, they much more resemble products of a written oral tradition in the way they have been organized, the structure, also the style, the use of a certain formulae and repetition and oral direct speech, etc. I mean, it much more resembles, for example, the epic of Gilgamesh, which was the product of a written oral tradition, than purely oral traditions that we know from Africa, for example. And a lot of elements that were thought to be typical oral in Homer actually have now shown to be present also in written documents. So it would be much better to understand Homer as a product of a mixed oral written tradition, and that some parts of Homer, for example, the catalogue of ships, that could have been written down already much earlier. And I think we have a very nice parallel with the Epic of Gilgamesh, because it's the most famous epic from the ancient Near East. And there we can trace its development over, almost a millennium, because it was written down on clay, which is quite durable. And there we see that, it started out with individual stories about a King Gilgamesh who once ruled in the third millennium BC or so. And at a certain point, these stories were merged into a unified poem, and that was then copied over time. But at the same time, it was a written composition, but it was also still performed orally, and there was a very lively oral tradition around these stories. So I think such a scenario would really tie in very well with Homer, and would also explain that we have so many ancient relics in there, and especially in that some very archaic elements of the language, how they could have survived without being changed for such a long period of time.
So fascinating. Thanks.
So Homer sat there at his desk with a stack of palm leaves to write on. I like that. All right. Well, thank you so much for joining us.
No, thank you.
We'll have you back and keep well in Leiden. I hope all goes well there soon. All right. Well, thank you.
Thanks again.
Thank you for having us.
Hope to see you soon again.
All right. We're back. And I'm joined now by Nicole Budrovich, my colleague at the Getty, a curatorial assistant who specializes in researching the collection. How are you doing, Nicole?
Hi, I'm doing well. Working from home as everyone else is. And
it's been a long time now, hasn't it? March?
Yeah.
And we're in November, so we're all working at home. How is that? How are you handling that?
It's been interesting. There's been phases of quarantine for sure. And I think finding the good work from home situation, but also the endless Zoom meetings have been both fun and they continue. And it's been pretty good, but surprisingly productive for not being in the office.
Well, that's good. So you're able to do work, you're able to get access to tools that you need for research.
Yeah.
But you do get away, right? Get out of the house.
Yeah. So there's a bit of cabin fever, especially over the summer and with stricter lockdowns. And my sister and I took the opportunity to get out of town and go to Yosemite. It had been closed for the early part of the summer and it only reopened in June. And so it was amazing because it was pretty empty. Nature had kind of reclaimed the park. And yeah, we went on some great hikes. And on one of these hikes, we actually came upon a bear, which was exciting and scary.
let's have a look at that. You sent me the video there. So let's see if I can get that up. Here we go.
All right. Our first Yosemite bear. Go bears. More like go away bears. It's a tall tree. I'm impressed. Camel bear. Hi, bear.
And you watched him come down too, right?
So we turned a corner and basically heard this rustling sound, scratching sound, and looked, we assumed the bear would be at ground level and kind of looked around confused only to see it way high up in the tree. And luckily we were able to, the path kept a safe distance. So we waited for him to come down.
Oh, and here he's coming down.
Love that chapter. All the sweet, sweet tree branches that he wanted. Oh, yeah. Okay, I don't grab that one. Okay, Nicole, go chase him away. last time I touched the bear's rotten egg.
Okay, well, that was pretty exciting, I'd say. And what did you think of the bear?
Yeah, so several things. First, I was just surprised at its agility. It could kind of climb up this tree and climb down, used its hands like human hands. And it had this, you think, it seeing a bear in the wild, it was just like, oh my goodness, this is kind of different than what I imagine them in other ways. And being a classicist, I immediately thought of bears in antiquity.
Of course, that's what we do, yes.
Yeah, that's what we do. And the human quality of it, kind of grabbing the branches, breaking them off, throwing them down, it had this, it felt like human hands. And it reminded me of Callisto, this famous figure from antiquity, this woman who was transformed into a bear. And we can get into the myth of her, but so yeah, that kind of human.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, we should talk about Callisto. It's quite a sad story, actually.
Yeah, it's a sad story. There's several versions of the myth, but Callisto was a priestess or a maiden who followed Artemis and was not allowed to, for various reasons, she ended up being impregnated by Zeus. And whether Zeus came in the guise of Artemis or how he tricked her into doing this, but basically this was against the rules of being a follower of Artemis. And so Callisto, once her pregnancy was discovered by the goddess, she was cast out, and depending who you ask, she was, after she gave birth, transformed into a bear as punishment or to hide her from the jealous gods. And yeah, and so it's a, so she, and then again, the myths vary, but basically this transformation because of having wronged her rights as a follower of Artemis.
Yeah, no, it's quite a sad story. I mean, Zeus's rape of all these women is not a nice thing. And I think the poets recognize that. Ovid is quite clear in our famous, probably most famous version that we know today is Ovid's recounting of it. And he, you know, he really emphasizes her sort of horror and shame and guilt. He says, after the rape, while Callisto was, she felt the grove, she was in the sacred grove, was odious and the wood seemed knowing. I thought it was very beautiful and sad. And then she was, her son, she did give birth to her son, Arcas, who's the eponymous founder of Arcadia in the Peloponnese in central Greece, very ancient wooded area that we think of as the primordial wilderness, I suppose. That's how it was thought of. But we know that the reason both of us are interested in this, one reason anyway, is that the Getty has a really good depiction of it. It's not very common in ancient art, but it is occasionally. So let's look at that.
Yeah, the metamorphosis.
yes. On a early 4th century South Italian vase, Apulian vase, right?
Yeah. Oh, I love this object. And it's just, it's a beautiful piece that's usually on view when we're open. And the details are amazing. Here you have Callisto, she's seated on a rock, kind of gazing down at her hand. And it's in the process of transforming into a bear's claw, a paw. Yeah. And even her ear is kind of also elongated. And just on the bottom far right, you can see her son, Arcas. Yeah,
that's on the other side.
Yeah, on the other side, yeah.
He's being rescued by Hermes, the god Hermes, who takes him away as Callisto, poor Callisto, is being turned into a bear. And this vase, actually, they're quite rare. And this vase wasn't known until the early 70s. And it helped identify some other fragments, similar fragments, like, oh, here's a detail of her.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Oh no, just that it's the artist has really captured kind of the tragic nature of her story.
To get her paw in disbelief. Yeah, and it comes from this very, there's another very nice fragment in Boston by one of the best artists of the time.
Yeah, and I love this because they didn't know what it was. It was misidentified, right?
Right, you know, they thought it might be a centaurus or something, you know.
Yeah, comparison, they were able to figure out, oh wait, this is Callisto.
You know, no, it's not a very common scene. It shows up at this time and we're not sure why. There is a reference to her appearing in a wall painting by Polygnotus at Delphi, but otherwise it's pretty unusual. What else have we got here? I just want to mention, since I was there, it's been a while, over 10 years now. I went to Mount Lycaon in Arcadia. This is the highest point, the birthplace of Zeus. So all of this myth is centered on Arcadia. And you know, it's not far from Olympia, also you can actually walk there through the mountain passes. But there's something mysterious about this area. They always considered Arcadia as being very primitive and with strange rites. And Callisto was the daughter, by most mythical accounts, of King Lycaon. And he had a pretty hard time too. So there were rumors of cults where they would sacrifice humans and eat them, you know, cannibalistic rites, which are pretty abhorrent to the Greeks generally. And there's a myth that Zeus came and King Lycaon didn't believe he was the god and served him human flesh at a banquet or tried to. And Zeus turned them into a wolf. So we have this also a tradition of werewolves. It seems to run in the family, turning into animals. You didn't see any wolves in Yosemite, did you?
We didn't.
Well, there's something for your next trip.
Yeah, for next time.
Yeah. No, it's a University of Arizona excavations here now. It's really fantastic with the big ash altar on the top. But they tell me they haven't found any human bones or wolf yet. But let's see. Oh, and also I found another coin of Mantinea, sort of in the northeast of Arcadia, used a bear. I'm sure there are bears around. We know there are bears all over Europe.
Yeah, and I guess, yes.
We didn't talk about the constellation.
Yes, so there's various endings to the myth, and in one version, Arcas, her son, has now grown up and he's a hunter, and either he chases her into the Temple of Artemis or into a sacred space and trying to hunt her and is about to kill her, or various versions, but in any event, to prevent this matricide, he doesn't know it's his mother because she's a bear. The gods transform them both into constellations and throw them up into the sky. So we have the Ursa bear, major and minor, are Big and Little Dipper.
And they, yes, and they're very well known. They're very well known in antiquity. In antiquity, they never dip below the horizon. They circled the North Star. So very important constellations. That's one way to save her. So, and then as we go on in antiquity, as I say, I think Ovid is the main source. It's in several other writers as well, but it does show up occasionally in.
Yeah, I love this example, just to briefly, this is a mosaic at Lacmus. This would originally be on the floor and you'd walk over it. But the center scene is actually Callisto being discovered pregnant by Artemis when they're at the bath or bathing. And it's Artemis kind of on the left gesturing to cast her out. And there's an unrelated scene of hunting around them, but there's a bear in the hunting just above. And so it's kind of possibly hinting at her transformation. And possibly her son, who is the hunter.
Yeah, that's good. But, and of course, the story is very popular all through the Renaissance as well. I thought we could end with newly acquired picture by the National Gallery in London and Edinburgh jointly of a Titian version of the scene with Diana, Artemis, discovering the pregnant Callisto and making her leave the party of her accompanying women. So again, quite sad, but lovely painting and excuse for Renaissance artists to paint all these naked women. I think it's a very fine thing. It was actually paired with an Actaeon. There's another case of someone turning into an animal. We don't have time for Actaeon today. But I want to thank you for joining us, Nicole. It sounds like you're having fun.
Thanks for having me.
And when you run into some more animals, let me know.
I'll keep my eyes peeled for bears.
Okay, all right. Well, that is very good.
Great.
Thank you so much. I will see you later.
See you later. Until next time.